Chinese President Xi Jinping and U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken agree to stabilize trade ties.
China's central bank cuts key lending rates as it seeks to prop up growth.
The Philippines begins to roll out bivalent COVID-19 vaccines to medical workers.
And ABS-CBN's It's Showtime, airing on GMA Network's GTV channel.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crow.
And I'm Denise Inside.
You're watching Top Story. Progress in thawing the frosty relations between the world's two superpowers. The U.S. and China agreeing to stabilize ties following the rare visit of Washington's top diplomat to Beijing. Here's the full story.
It was the highest level meeting in Beijing between U.S. and Chinese leaders in years.
Very candid, very in depth, and in places constructive. And in other places, we have a lot more work to do.
While both sides agreed on the need to stabilize communication, Secretary of State Antony Blinken will not return to Washington with an agreement from the Chinese side to set up military-to-military communication channels.
At this moment, China has not agreed to move forward with that.
Washington says military communication lines should remain open in the event of a crisis. Earlier this month, a Chinese warship came within 140 meters of a U.S. military destroyer, forcing it to slow down to avoid a crash. A week prior, over the South China Sea, a Chinese fighter jet flew across the nose of a U.S. surveillance plane. Tensions between the two nations are also high over Taiwan. China has said it wants to control the Democratic Island by military force if necessary.
The likelihood is that that would produce an economic crisis that could affect quite literally the entire world.
50% of commercial container traffic goes through the Taiwan Strait, and 70% of semiconductors are manufactured on Taiwan. On Chinese-Russian relations, Blinken said Chinese leaders have repeatedly assured the U.S. that China will not supply Russia with lethal aid that could be used in Moscow's unprovoked war against Ukraine.
What we do have ongoing concerns about, though, are Chinese firms, companies, that may be providing technology that Russia can use to advance its aggression in Ukraine. And we have asked the Chinese government to be very vigilant about that.
Analysts warn that Beijing is using the move to gauge global reaction.
Clearly kind of testing the waters to see what they might do with respect to helping Russia and Ukraine. I think, as far as I can tell, the Chinese motive is they want to maintain access to the European markets while helping Putin as much as possible and creating IOUs, if you will.
U.S.-Chinese relations hit new lows since the U.S. shot down a Chinese spy balloon earlier this year that flew through U.S. airspace. Blinken's trip was originally set for February, but was rescheduled after the balloon incident. World leaders seemed pleased with the Blinken-Xi talks, with German Chancellor Olaf Scholz hailing the meeting as a sign of a much-needed normalization of relations between Washington and Beijing. Carla Babb, VOA News, Washington.
A Philippine senator, meanwhile, seeks to bring China's aggressive actions in Manila's waters before the United Nations General Assembly. Senator Risa Ontiveros says the Philippine government should sponsor a resolution before the UN Assembly that would rally international support in urging China to stop harassing Filipino fisherfolk. She insists China's continuing aggression in the West Philippine Sea is a constant rejection of international law.
President Marcos says some progress has been made on discussions with China regarding fishing rights in the West Philippine Sea. Our correspondent Job Banahan is on the line with the details. Job, what can you tell us?
Philippines' discussions with China on fishing rights in the West Philippine Sea has made some progress. This is according to President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. as he highlighted the importance of communication with the Eastern power. In a chance interview with reporters, Marcos recalled that the Chinese vessel shadowed BRP Francisco Dagohoy Thursday last week after delivering aid to Pag-asa Island and noted that it did not block its pathway. Aside from this, Marcos said coordination is being done on Evergreen's fishing ban in the disputed waters. Let's hear what he has to say.
So there's a little progress there. Kaya ang actually ang BIFAR merong projection na lalaki ang huli because nabawasan nga yung nabigyan ng pagkakataon ng ating mga farmers. That is because we are continuing to talk to the Chinese government, to President Xi in every way.
Marcos also said he stressed to President Xi the importance of putting premium to the welfare of fishermen in the area as they are affected by the development.
Huwag na natin pag-usapan yung teritoryo. Dahil hindi naman tayo makakapag-decide ngayon dito, mag-uusap tayo. Unahan niya yung mga fisheries. Slowly, slowly, alam mo na, these things do not come very quickly. Slowly, slowly. But we are slowly making progress because the key to that was really the improved communication between the Philippine government and the Chinese government.
Ron, the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources, or BIFAR, on Saturday said Filipino fishermen could have caught more fish in the West Philippine Sea if no Chinese incursions occurred in recent years. BIFAR spokesperson Naz Beguero said the West Philippine Sea contributes 6% to the country's total fisheries production as of last year. This is equivalent to 275,872 metric tons with commercial and local fishing production combined. In January, during his trip to China, Marcos said that President Xi vowed to find a compromise and find a solution for Filipino fishermen to return to traditional fishing grounds in the disputed areas in the South China Sea. China and the Philippines are at odds over the South China Sea, with Beijing claiming sovereignty over almost the entire area despite an international court ruling that its claims have no legal basis. Ron?
Thanks for that report, Jab Manahan.
In related news, the Philippine Fisheries Bureau is allocating funds to boost the catch of fisherfolk operating in or near the West Philippine Sea. The plan includes providing boats and other equipment to fisherfolk in Ilocos, Central Luzon, and Mimaropa. The agency says it will be setting aside close to 80 million pesos for this initiative, which is also meant to improve the local economy and people's livelihood. The Philippine Statistics Authority previously reported the haul of fishermen in the West Philippine Sea has dwindled between 2021 and 2022.
Isa po itong insatiba ng pamahalaan na maglaan ng mga proyekto, tutukan ang West Philippine Sea pagdating po doon sa pagpapayabong ng ating fishers production.
The Philippine Justice Department confident former Bureau of Corrections Chief Gerald Bantag is still in the country. This is after Filipino authorities offered a 3 million peso reward for information that will lead to the arrest of Bantag and his former deputy Ricardo Sulweta. They are the main suspects in the murder of journalist Percy Lapid last year.
The information that has come forth all revolve around the same general area. So we have eyes and ears on him. It's just that we need to pinpoint exactly where he is and to time the operation, or I guess the arrest, properly so as to catch him off guard. It seems as though, based on the credible information, that he seems to be moving around the certain general area. No public funds was used for the reward. The reward was put up by concerned individuals and groups who are likewise interested and keen to see this case continue and move forward. Again, it's a very important case and it involves media freedom, freedom of speech, as well as the right of our citizens to life.
DOJ Assistant Secretary Mico Clavano meanwhile announced informants will now get the reward upon the successful arrest of both Bantag and Zulweta to expedite their capture. Clavano earlier told ANC the reward will not be given if the suspects are not convicted.
The Philippine Justice Department, meanwhile, says suspended lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. may soon be designated a terrorist. It was Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla who first floated the idea during a Senate hearing into Governor Roel de Gamo's killing back in April. Teves is deemed the main mastermind in that murder, but he has denied the allegations.
We are quite confident that the the designation will happen in the next few months. Mm. Although we have to be very, very careful and we have to be very diligent in the way we gather the evidence. His situation will change because as his assets are frozen and his bank accounts are frozen, it may limit or it may hinder his movement around Asia. It may also hinder the resources that he has to fund any of the, his, well, if ever there are any more unlawful activities, that may be hindered as well.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. urged to walk the talk on his supposed commitment to freedom of information. The Center for Media Freedom and Responsibility says the access of journalists to information remains limited, coming from a restrictive environment during the Duterte administration. But the CMFR adds, fighting for FOI also entails support from other sectors of society.
The whole idea here is that he speaks of the whole of nation. Well, I think he should start with the whole of government and begin to demonstrate that any of these efforts are actually going to be pursued by all agencies. The press must also hear from the people. It must also hear from policy groups, from business, from church, from academia, from all the other different sectors, from civil society, basically acting and expressing as one that we want freedom of information, press freedom, and the freedom from fear for what we say and what we speak.
Aside from committing to freedom of information, Marcos also said fake news has no place in his administration.
The mayor of Ginobatan town in Albay justifies his order to evacuate residents who live outside the Mayon Volcano's danger zone. Albay Governor Greg Slagman called him out for the unnecessary evacuation, saying this has strained resources in evacuation centers.
Nakapag-evacuate po kami kasama ang dalawang barangay.
Uh-oh.
Because po itong dalawang barangay is nasa high risk talaga siya. Pag sinabi high risk, itong dalawang barangay, napapalamanan po ito or napapagitnaan ng dalawang gali or main channel ng Mount Mayon na may mga factors po na malalagay sila sa peligro.
Uh-oh.
Number one, pagka may mga malalakas sa pag-uulan and ang isa po factor pa is di naman namin hiningi if mag-major eruption. Eh, number one po sila na apektuhan and mahirap po sila i-transport going to evacuation center.
The Philippines begins the rollout of bivalent COVID vaccines to health workers. A ceremonial vaccination was held Tuesday at the medical center in Batangas province. The hospital chief says hundreds of doctors and nurses will get the jabs as well as some 1,600 personnel. The health department is targeting to get the shots to 244,000 locals in the Calabarzon region. The bivalent jabs target the original COVID strain and the Omicron subvariant. The country received its first supply of some 390,000 doses early this month.
Ang COVID nandiyan pa. Nakikita pa rin natin na may mga kaso pa rin tayo at yung mga karaniwang kaso na nakikita, iyan yung variants na ginawa ng bakuna. So ito yung makakatulong na panlaban dito sa mga ganitong variant.
The health department's plan to grant temporary licenses for nursing graduates who failed the board exam draws mixed reactions. On Monday, newly appointed health chief Ted Herbosa suggested board takers who scored 70 to 74% on the nursing exam should be given temporary licenses for plantilla positions. The president of the Philippine College of Physicians, Dr. Ron Jean Solante, believes the plan is a good alternative for filling the roughly 4,500 nurse vacancies in government hospitals.
I think it's a good alternative plan, no? Kumbaga, ano to siya? Plano para lang madagdagan ang nursing personnel sa mga hospital. Ang importante dito, these are all board eligible, no? So meaning they are already competent enough to do nursing work because graduate na sila sa nurse. It's just a matter that when they will be incorporated or isama na natin sila doon sa mga hospital, they have to undergo training also.
But the Philippine Nurses Association said the DOH should prioritize employing those who pass the exam.
Ang nabanggit po ni DOH Secretary Herbosa, ang kakulangan natin ay nasa 4,000 plus. And considering na itong pumasa nating May 2023 Nurse Licensure Examination ay 10,764. So why not na lang take into consideration to prioritize natin yung ito pong pumasa sa 10,746 at i-open natin ang plantilla position para ma-fill ito.
Various groups weighing in on a bill seeking a return to the June to March school calendar. An association of private schools says any call to adjust the academic calendar should be studied carefully as a shift cannot be abrupt. It adds stakeholders must look at other ways to address the impact of climate change on the education sector.
Kailangan din natin mag-adapt sa current climate situation natin, no? And I think naman din, no, we have the necessary capacities, no, or capabilities para improve. There is room for improvement ng ating infrastructure and facilities. Hindi natin basta-basta na pwedeng i-adjust bigla, no? Kasi of course may mga substantial considerations tayo dito, and I think the fact that TEPED is studying this shows that there is there are really major considerations na kailangan ma-address muna.
The National Parent Teachers Association meanwhile raises some concerns should the proposal to revert to the old academic calendar push through.
Kung babagoy natin, we move back three months and a half yun. For the next 2 years, para ma-adapt tayo, walang bakasyon ng 60 days, in order to cope up with that 2.5 months na mawawala po sa mga bata. Kailangan nang mag-move sa June ang ating klase. Mag-move. Sabi ko nga, this is only the first year na naranas na ng face-to-face.
House lawmakers from the minority bloc earlier filed the bill seeking to revert the school calendar starting next year, citing intense heat during the summer season. The current school calendar in the Philippines runs from August to May.
The Philippines bids a final farewell to former Senator and AFP Chief Rodolfo Biazon. He was laid to rest at the Heroes Cemetery in Taguig this morning. The armed forces accorded fully military honors for their former chief. Biazon passed away on June 12, the Independence Day of the Philippines, after being hospitalized since May due to pneumonia. He was 88.
Chinese billionaire Jack Ma's Alibaba Group announces a new CEO for the e-commerce giant. In a surprise announcement Tuesday, Alibaba said Eddie Wu will succeed outgoing CEO Daniel Zhang. Wu, one of the co-founders of Alibaba, will serve in that capacity while also staying in place as chairman of the Taboa and Tmall Group. Alibaba's executive vice chair, Joseph Tsai, meanwhile, will succeed Zhang as chairman. The changes take effect on September 10. The succession plan is the biggest executive reshuffling since Alibaba announced plans to restructure. The company bared in March it will split into 6 business groups.
Airbus unveils the biggest plane deal in history on the opening day of the Paris Air Show. The European aerospace firm won an order for 500 narrow-body jets from Indian budget carrier IndiGo. The multi-billion dollar deal is the largest ever by number of aircraft, eclipsing Air India's provisional purchase of 470 jets earlier this year. IndiGo's CEO said this is just the beginning, as India and the Indian aviation market will only continue to grow. Indian carriers now have the second largest order book, with an over 6% share of the industry backlog, behind only the United States.
The Manila International Airport Consortium defends the 267 billion peso price tag of its unsolicited proposal to rehabilitate the Ninoy Aquino International Airport. The mega consortium, composed of the country's biggest conglomerates and a foreign partner, had raised its bid again, adding a 57 billion peso upfront concession payment to the government. The group asserts the size of the project requires long-term investment and commitment.
The Philippines has no time to lose. Among the competitors for the Philippines, Thailand has the most. The Philippines, again, with the most wonderful tourist destinations, was at 8 million. So it's absolutely critical that the Philippines has an airport that everyone around says, oh my gosh, have you been to Naiya lately? You can get from front door to the shops in 5 minutes. It's such a wonderful experience. You can get in and out, everything works, the baggage handling works. Once that happens, I think that'll be a huge boon to tourism. Fixing this airport is one of the most important things we can do to drive economic growth in this country.
Under the master plan, the terminal spaces will be expanded and new operating processes and technologies will be installed. The consortium allays concerns on higher fees once the Naiya has been rehabilitated.
The Naiya fees right now are actually the lowest in the region. Just fair that a higher fee will be charged for us to have a really high-performing airport.
Naiya has consistently ranked among the world's worst airports. It's been hit with a string of power outages in recent months, causing massive flight delays.
The Philippines posted its widest balance of payments deficit in 3 months. Data from the central bank showed the BOP, a measure of the country's cash flow statement with the rest of the world, hit a deficit of $439 million in May. That's due to outflows mainly from the government's net foreign currency withdrawals to pay its foreign debt and various expenditures. The BOP position for the first 5 months of the year, however, remains at a surplus of $2.9 billion. Meanwhile, the country's gross international reserves slightly decreased to 100.6 billion pesos as of end May. The BSP says the latest GIR level represents a more than adequate external liquidity buffer, equivalent to 7.4 months' worth of imports of goods, as well as payments of services and primary income.
The Philippine government's efficiency drops in 2023. In the World Competitiveness Yearbook, the Philippines dropped to 52nd place from 48th in 2022. According to the index, all sub-factors under the Philippine government's efficiency suffer declines. Public finance fell by 4 spots, as did tax policy, institutional framework, business legislation, and societal framework. In contrast, the yearbook showed the Philippines' economic performance factor improved from 53rd in 2022 to 40th this year.
The Philippine Central Bank and retail giant SM unveil the so-called coin deposit machine. Jackie Pascual is now on the line to tell us more about that. Jackie?
Hi, good afternoon, Denise. The Banco Central of Pilipinas reveals there is a coin shortage in the country, with each Filipino possibly keeping hundreds of coins in their house without them realizing it, which is why BSP unveiled its first coin deposit machine at the SM Mall of Asia today. The machine will convert coins into shopping vouchers, or the coins can be transferred to an e-wallet account. BSP Governor Felipe Medalla said there is an urgent need to recirculate the coins, which are usually kept in drawers or containers inside the house. He said that ideally, coins should change hands every 1 week, but instead, right now, it's changing hands every 6 months because the coins are kept inside the house. This is not good, he said, as coins need to be circulated in the economy and should be used. There are 39 billion pieces of coins in the country, and most are just kept hidden and not being used. Medalla even said that it's more expensive to make a 25 centavo coin than to print a 1,000 peso bill. Hence, coins should be recirculated. Aside from SM, there are also coin deposit machines at the Robinson's Ermita and Festival Supermall in Muntinlupa. the central bank says they will deploy more coin deposit machines to more areas soon, including the provinces. The coin deposit machine is free of charge or free to use. Old and damaged coins, however, won't be counted, as well as foreign coins or those random tokens. And that's the latest. Denise, back to you.
Thanks, Jackie.
The Transport Department cites easing inflation and rising employment as reasons behind the approval of the fare hike in the LRT Lines 1 and 2. The OTR Assistant Secretary for Railways, Georgette Aquino, says the fare hike underwent public consultation last March. President Marcos ordered the deferral of the increase last April, citing rising inflation and living costs.
Sabi po ng Director for Operations ng MRT3, in 2 weeks time sila daw ay mag-file po ulit. I-re-refine nila ang kanilang petition for fare increase. Pagkasabit po nila ng kanilang petition, kailangan po nila yon i-publish. Meron pa pong public hearing. 30 days after that public hearing is the evaluation period and the approval.
Meanwhile, the MRT plans to follow suit with its own fare hike petition in the coming weeks.
Let's now check on the weather here in the Philippines with Pegaso forecaster Veronica Torres. Veronica?
Good afternoon to you and all of our audience. As of now, intertropical convergence zone is affecting Palawan and Mindanao. That's why we're experiencing cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorm over Palawan and Basilan, Sulu, and Tawi-Tawi. For Metro Manila and the rest of the country, we're expecting better weather conditions, although we're still expecting chances of localized thunderstorms. So as of now, we're not monitoring any low-pressure area or tropical cyclone near or inside our Philippine area of responsibility, and we don't have any gale warning raised over any parts of the country. And that's the latest from Pagasa Weather Forecasting Center, Veronica Torres.
Thanks, Veronica.
Up next, scores die in northern India amid an extreme heat wave.
An official search for a missing vessel touring the Titanic wreckage. More news when we return.
So watching top story, an ongoing heat wave in India leaves nearly 170 people dead, worsening the situation, a shortage of medical supplies and widespread power and water outages due to sweltering temperatures. The Indian government has issued high temperature warnings, with the highest reaching 43.5 degrees Celsius. Authorities are investigating the cause of the deaths, saying there's no concrete evidence yet they are tied to the weather.
On the opposite end, freezing temperatures in the central western region of Brazil have resulted in the mass deaths of livestock. In Mato Grosso do Sul, low temperatures have killed more than 1,000 bulls, cows, and calves. Local officials not ruling out more animals dying of hypothermia in the coming days due to low temperatures. Authorities estimate losses of more than $600,000.
The United Nations has adopted the first ever international treaty to govern the high seas and protect remote ecosystems that are vital to humanity. Now, this comes after more than 15 years of discussions. The High Seas Treaty will establish a legal framework to extend environment protection policies to international waters, which cover more than 60% of the Earth's surface. UN Chief Antonio Guterres urged all countries to spare no effort to ensure the treaty is signed and ratified as soon as possible.
A massive search operation is underway to locate a submarine that went missing on its way to exploring the wreckage of the Titanic. U.S. and Canadian ships and planes are now scouring the waters of southeastern Canada for any sign of the vessel. The U.S. Coast Guard said one pilot and four passengers are on board the submersible, among them British billionaire Hamish Harding. The vessel lost contact nearly 2 hours after it began diving towards the wreckage site.
We understand from the operator of the vessel that the vessel was designed with a 96-hour sustainment capability if there was an emergency on board. And so we're using that time, making the best use of every moment of that time to locate the vessel. Right now, our focus is getting on as much capability into the area as we can and understanding that full capability of those assets that are being deployed. Our aerial assets that are being deployed have the capability to do both visual and radar searches, and the Canadians' asset had the ability to drop sonar buoys and listen. And so we're using all that information to improve our search capability.
Four people hurt following a string of axe attacks in New Zealand. Authorities say a 24-year-old man entered three Chinese restaurants in Auckland Monday night and randomly attacked people. The suspect is under police custody and was due to appear in court Tuesday. Authorities did not give a motive for the attacks.
Dozens of Afghan refugees have been entering Serbia every day with hopes of eventually reaching Western Europe. This report tells us about the harrowing journey they take in search for a better life.
Asadullah graduated from Kabul University in Afghanistan, but could not find a job and decided to leave his country. His journey took him to Serbia, where he spoke with VOA as he neared a refugee camp.
I've been en route for 10 or 11 days, passing mountains, valleys, and deserts. I am not sure if the camp will let us inside and register us.
Asadullah, who did not want to provide his last name, isn't alone waiting outside this refugee reception and transit camp in Obrenovac, on the outskirts of Serbian capital, Belgrade. Dozens of Afghan refugees enter Serbia daily, hoping to be registered and reach Western European countries. Shaukatullah, who only provided his first name, says before reaching Serbia, he was deported repeatedly back to Turkey from Bulgaria.
We were deported four times. Bulgaria arrested us. They made their dogs bite us. They beat us. Other than that, they take whatever you have. We faced many difficulties reaching Serbia. Now we are in Serbia, in a camp.
The refugees here have taken treacherous routes to Europe, traveling through Iran, Turkey, and Bulgaria to reach Serbia. Another Afghan refugee, Murtaza Ahmadi, says he suffered illness and injuries on his journey, but he is determined to reach his destination, Germany.
I got sick on the way. My foot is injured. No one helps us. I do not know who is to blame, ourselves, the UN, or Serbia.
For decades, Serbia served as an avenue for migrants to reach Western Europe. However, it is now more challenging for refugees to go from Serbia to their preferred destinations. According to a UN Refugee Agency report, Afghans made up 36% of the nearly 130,000 refugee arrivals in Serbia in 2022. Syrian refugees were in second place with 29%. For Wali Aryan in Belgrade, Serbia, Bejan Hamdard, VOA News.
The Kremlin cites security concerns for its decision to reject assistance in areas of Russian-held Ukraine flooded by the Kakhovka Dam breach. The United Nations said on Sunday that Moscow had declined its offers of help as the death toll rose and filthy water forced the closure of beaches in southern Ukraine. The collapse of the Moscow-controlled dam on June 6 unleashed floodwaters across southern Ukraine and Russian-controlled parts of the Kherson region, destroying homes and farmlands and cutting off supplies to residents.
ABS-CBN's multi-awarded and longest-running noontime show, It's Showtime, finds a new home in rival GMA7's free-to-air TV network, GTV. It's Showtime will air on GTV beginning July 1st. The move comes as the show's contract with TV5 expires at the end of June. In a statement, ABS-CBN thanked TV5 Chairman Manny Pangilinan for bringing It's Showtime to a wider audience. ABS-CBN also clarifies they were offered the 4:30 p.m. time slot, but ABS-CBN respectfully declined. It's Showtime has been entertaining Kapamilyas, or ABS-CBN audiences, for over a decade. It airs on the Kapamilya channel, Kapamilya Online Live, A to Z Channel 11, and now GTV from Mondays to Saturdays.
In a world where messages can be sent instantaneously, police in India's Odisha state are preserving a relic from the past. Carrier pigeons. In a nondescript building, more than 100 Belgian homing pigeons are being reared and trained to carry messages during worst-case scenarios. The origins in the British colonial era, pigeons used to carry messages between police stations in remote regions and help to keep in touch with police units on the move. The birds proved to be a lifeline during the 1999 Odisha cyclone, which destroyed all modes of communication in the state.
Women on an island in Central Africa are turning trash into jewelry. This report tells us more.
Annabella Pina and Zinha Mendes were once unemployed. Today, they have started a business that transforms glass bottles into jewelry and employs at least half a dozen people.
It is an organization creating value of what was waste.
The first step was a training course in Ghana, sponsored by the HBD Group, a private South African investment company that also invests in tourism on the Príncipe Island.
We take it to the oven. We already have our brand. This is a white bottle necklace with yellow and blue pigment. This earring was made with a beer bottle and has yellow pigment. This is our brand, the Príncipe brand.
They work in Roca de Porto Real, a village located in the central part of Príncipe.
After we take the beads out of the oven, we wash, dry, polish, measure, and glue.
Com a lima, depois tiramos a medida do fio.
Pina says in March she traveled to Senegal to train several women from Guinea-Bissau, Tunisia, and France on techniques for transforming bottles into jewelry. Annabella Pina and Zinha Mendes say there are other uses of recycled glass and hope to turn glass bottles into sand to make the material accessible for construction.
Now we intend to save money to buy a machine to grind the glass. Here, there is a shortage of sand. If we have the machine, we would sell a lot of glass sand.
The two entrepreneurs also manufacture organic compost for use in agriculture. Fatima Cassandra, the regional secretary for social affairs and human capital, says the women set an example in their communities and embody efforts for women empowerment.
They are a reference. Tourists want to see what is ours, and they are able to show that. We make a point of spreading the word so that they inspire other women.
Pina and Mendes' work is also a draw for the dozens of tourists who visit the island of Príncipe. For Oscar Medeiros in São Tomé e Príncipe, Bárbara Santos, VOA News.
Philippine shares see a muted trading session on Tuesday, days before the Banco Central's policy decision. But one analyst believes another pause in the BSP's rate hike will not be enough to move the market up. More in this report.
Stocks in Asia grapple for direction after China's central bank cut its key lending rates. The move comes as Beijing seeks to prop up growth after a series of data releases that point to a slowdown in China's economy. The Philippine Stock Exchange Index ended almost flat at 64.48. Miko Sayo, founder of Tupitero.com, says he won't be surprised if the index drops to 6,200 or even 6,100 in the short term.
The 6,400 is acting as a major support for the market right now. It's the level that the market has been holding on for the last 3 months. So we've been consolidating at this range of between 64 and 6,700 for 3 months now. If you listen to all the analysts, you know, parang everybody's cautiously bullish because they think that prices are already cheap. But that doesn't necessarily mean that it can't go lower.
Sayo also said the Banco Central's policy decision on Thursday will not likely move the market.
We're looking for a catalyst in the market. I'm afraid I don't think it won't be on Thursday, you know, because I think it's widely expected that the BSP will hold rates unchanged. And if that happens, I don't think it would be a market-moving event.
In corporate stories, Alcyon's Consolidated Resources confirms plans to invest 6 billion pesos in the next 3 years. ACR is gearing up for its entry into the renewable energy space with the launch of its 14.5-megawatt hydropower plant in Sarangani Province by the year end. Meanwhile, the joint venture between telco giant Globe, Ayala Corporation, and Singapore's STT GDC is expanding capacity this year. STT GDC Philippines says it will increase its capacity by 5.2 megawatts in its three data centers in Metro Manila and in Cavite. The company is also planning to scale operations to cater to global hyperscalers and other segments. And finally, a price hike may be in the cards for Shakey's Pizza. Its chairman, Chris Paul, says prices of raw materials remain high, so an increase between 3 to 5% is possible.
Price increases to consumers are always seen as a last recourse in the group. So what we've tried to do is always try to create the value first, present the value, and then pass on some of the price to our consumers. And it is good that our target consumers have a bigger capacity to absorb price points than operating at the lower end of the market base. But we never want to abuse that.
With over 2,000 book titles of various genres, Penguin Classics has the world in its shelves, and its Filipino-American publisher is now on the hunt for Filipino authors. Monica Galozo reports.
Filipino literature is as diverse as it can get, ranging from classics to comics. Filipino-American Elda Rotor, vice president and publisher of Penguin Classics, has been going around the world sourcing classics to be published under Penguin Classics. Among the literature they have been sourcing the past couple of years are Asian and Asian-American literature, which includes works by Filipino authors. Some of the Filipino classics that they have published in recent years include Jose Rizal's Nolime Tangere, and El Filibusterismo, and Carlos Bulusan's America is in the Heart. Rotor says they have a good representation of Filipino classics. With nearly 2,000 titles, Penguin Classics represents a global bookshelf of the best works throughout history and across genres and disciplines. Rotor said much care is put into introducing these authors, who many are not aware of, into the global book market.
We always care about who we get to write that, because when we're stepping into the idea of introducing a classic, we have to assume that we're writing and publishing for a general reader, someone who has never heard of Jose Rizal, for instance. So how are you going to contextualize that?
Rotor's efforts are welcomed by the Filipino-American community in Norfolk, Virginia, as it breaks the mold of what Filipinos do for a living. She recently gave a talk to the Master of Fine Arts in Creative Writing students at the Old Dominion University, where Phil-Am community leaders and members were also present.
It's a great thrill to research other Filipino writers, and there are a lot of them, and there are a lot of beautifully talented Filipino poets and novelists.
For PhilAm businessman and community leader Ben Equiton, Rotor's position in Penguin Classics gives her the opportunity to further bring Filipinos to a global scene.
Her excellence in the field of publishing validates the fact that as Filipino-Americans, we cannot just be nurses. We can also excel in other fields like hers. Very important to have Filipino-Americans who can excel in this job because they are in the best position to articulate our Filipino culture, Filipino family values.
Meanwhile, Rotor's engagement with the creative writing students in the PhilAm community was made possible by the efforts of former Poet Laureate of Virginia and MFA professor Dr. Luisa Igloria. She invited Rotor to Old Dominion University to share her experiences in publishing and editing.
We are doing this as part of the professionalization series lecture series at the MFA program. And we invited her as a speaker because we think that she has a lot to share about her experiences in the realm of publishing and editing.
Rotor encourages aspiring writers and editors to find themselves a community and a mentor, and to ask questions, especially about people's journey.
Because life anecdotes are probably the most educational, and you'll be surprised how relatable people are when you find out where they came from. I also think it's really important to show your passion, especially when you're interviewing. Don't be shy to show yourself. Be proud of where you came from. Be proud of what type of storytelling you love.
Monica Galazzo, ABS-CBN News, Norfolk, Virginia.
And before we go, a groundbreaking primetime series in the U.S. earns rave reviews from the Filipino community in Los Angeles. Steve Angeles has more.
The Filipino community welcomed one of the hottest primetime network shows in the U.S. with a special panel and reception in Los Angeles recently. PhilAm Creative and One Down Media hosted the event featuring some of the stars and crew behind Fox's The Cleaning Lady at Kumu Studios.
We get so much support from the community, and so we want to give our support and love back. So that's why this panel is really exciting for us.
I'm really, really proud to be Filipino-American, and working on this show has meant a lot to me, obviously, because it incorporates a lot of Filipino culture, you know, a lot of things that all us Filipinos can relate to.
The hit series that follows the struggles of a Filipino-Cambodian family and touches on Pinoy values and issues such as immigration, labor, and familial ties has brought in many familiar faces, including actress Princess Punsalan.
It's very satisfying and fulfilling to be in this show. To have been a part of The Cleaning Lady. Because when I left the Philippines in 2005, I thought I was saying goodbye to acting. But now that I was able to get this chance, it just feels so good to be here. I'm just happy to be here. And I was so happy watching more and more content with Filipinos in it.
The show has also brought in new faces like PhilAm Creative's executive director Mark Lobella, who's guested on the series.
We're the second largest AAPI population in the country, and we're not even on like medical shows and stuff like that. So when we found The Cleaning Lady, it was so exciting. It was so incredible. We were just so happy.
While The Cleaning Lady has been slated for season 3, Hollywood has been battling a writer's strike since early May, and there has been no progress in contract negotiations. There's also possibility of a looming actor's strike, and unions for other Hollywood workers are entering negotiations with the studios. Showrunner Miranda Kwok admits the strikes could possibly delay the release of the upcoming season.
Well, it will, and obviously, you know, I stand in solidarity with the guild and with my fellow writers, and unfortunately, because there's actually a lot of uncertainty right now of how long the strike will last, you know, trying to have, you know, have some way to meet in the middle, you know, it's going to be a challenge. It's a challenge, and therefore, unfortunately, we just don't have a date yet that we can say because we don't know how long the strike will last.
But whenever filming does resume and new episodes air, Filipino fans are excited to see more of themselves and the stories on a hit primetime show. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Los Angeles.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Dinsai.
And I'm Ron Crows. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows. Begin to roll out bivalent COVID-19 vaccines to medical workers. and ABS.